nucleus at the center and the electron roaming around. And then further, one realized again, when higher energies became available, that a nucleus is also actually not point-like, though Rutherford thought so, and we are going to discuss this in detail. And that's then made up of protons and neutrons, whereas the protons and neutrons are actually themselves are also not point-like. And when you increase the energy and when you look at it with a higher energy probe with a slightly increased resolving powers, you find that the protons are made up of quarks. And if you keep on increasing this energy, then you find that the protons and neutrons consist at very high energies, looking almost like a free soup of quarks and gluons, but there doesn't seem to be anything further. This is a picture that I have drawn myself, but this is a slightly better drawn picture by an artist where you see this relative sizes, that if you say that the atomic size is one unit, a nucleus is about 10,000 times smaller than that. Proton is about 100,000 times smaller than an atom and 10 times smaller than a nucleus, roughly, for a small nucleus. And then for quarks and electrons, which we think are the ultimate elementary constituents of matter, we don't think they have any size. Experimentally, we only have a limit on their size. And we know that if they have a size, that size is smaller than 100,000th of an atom. So this is what we know. So in principle, we have begun a long time back, and the idea of what is elementary, beginning from the times of the times before Christ, when we thought of elements, I will come to that in my next slide, to chemical elements of Mendeleev, then we came to molecules, then we realized no, atoms are perhaps elementary. Then one realized no, perhaps nuclei are the ultimate constituent. And now we know that quarks and leptons are the ultimate constituents. And the subject that deals with this ultimate elementary constituents is elementary particle physics. So the concept of elementality has finally come home to roost in this, and we know that the fundamental particles are the quarks, the leptons, and the gauge bosons, which carry the forces, and those are the photons, WZ boson, and the gluon. So there are matter particles, quarks, and leptons, force carriers, photon, WZ boson, and the gluon, and the final piece of the puzzle, Higgs boson. So now you can ask the question, it's a very natural question to us, that is this going to go on like this, you know, picture within a picture within a picture, or is matter and the world around us like a Russian doll where you opened one doll, you got another one, at the end of it you had only space inside? And we believe that yes, we have most likely reached the innermost layer and there are no longer layers within layers. So this is what, you know, we have now realized, that early on the development in human scientific understanding had revealed layers within layers. And now today what I want to do is want to trace part of this inward bound journey, and then what I want to really show you, that the methods that uncovered this structure is essentially the same at each level. That means opening of each of these dolls was exactly the same, very similar process. There are mainly two different ways in which the scientists have inferred what lies at the heart of the matter. One is what I would call static methods. That is, you know, use the systematics that is observed in the properties of the system at macroscopic scale, such as pressure, volume, mass, or charge, you know, so on and so forth. And that we call, another word in a bigger sort of more general context, symmetry. And the second is scattering experiments, where you use a scattering of a probe from a body. So you can think of electron scattering, you can think of neutron scattering, you can think of light scattering, you can think of all kinds of things. And by the scattering, we get then the information about the structure of the body. So about static methods, the existence of atoms, for example, was postulated by looking at patterns in molecular and atomic weights, whereas the existence of electron was postulated by looking at patterns in the ionization. The existence of photon was indicated by the photoelectric effect, but it was confirmed by Compton scattering and change in the wavelength of light in the Compton scattering. Existence of a nucleus was inferred Rutherford from one of the first scattering experiments, and that's the Rutherford experiment. So I have tried to give you examples both of systematics and static properties and of the scattering experiments. Now, in general, when we do scattering experiments, we are used, and we have learned in science scattering in classical physics, for example. And the scattering experiments, we usually use this method as a way for learning about the interaction between the two bodies that scatter each other. So the second way of probing the structure is possible only when we have some knowledge of the dynamics at work. So what I want to emphasize here, that our knowledge as to what the fundamental building blocks of nature look like has grown as we have understood more and more how these blocks are put together. So, you know, I can say, let's begin with our ideas of elementarity in a time period BC. At that time, the Greeks thought that everything was made up of four elements. I mean, the word element really came from there. We still know earth, water, fire, and wind. We call them natural elements. And then there was Democritus, who wrote that by convention there is color, by convention there is sweetness, by convention bitterness. But in reality, there are only atoms and space, and these atoms and space, how they are arranged, will decide what are the properties, what are the things that we see around us. The ancient Indians also had a similar idea. They used to call them Pancha Mahabhutani, which in English I have written here, Pancha Mahabhutas. And surprisingly enough, they are the same four elements, earth, water, fire, wind. In Marathi, they are called, in Sanskrit, they are called Prithvi, Aap, Teja, Vayu. But the ancient Indians had one more element, and that was space. So Democritus anyway said that there are these plus space. And statements very similar to Democritus were made by Kanada in Vaisheshika Sutras in Upanishads. But mind you, this was just philosophy. The next big step came about 2000 years later, and it came from Sir Isaac Newton, the father of science, I would like to call. And this was 1700 AD, was roughly the time in that period, the beginning of what Steven Weinberg liked to call the Age of Enlightenment, when Sir Isaac Newton wrote Principia. He wrote one more book called Optics, and in this he defined a process of substantiating such philosophical ideas. And he said, now the smallest particles of matter may cohere by the strongest attraction and compose particles of weaker virtue. There are therefore agents in nature able to make particles of bodies stick together by very strong attractions, and it is the business of experimental philosophy to find them out. So this is an order that Sir Isaac Newton gave to the generations of coming experimental and theoretical physicists after him. So if you want to say what was the branch of science which dealt with elementary constituents of nature at that time, I would say it was experimental philosophy. So actually our belief as to what is elemental, as I already explained, really changed from the four to five elements from the times before Christ to thermodynamics, which described three states of matters, where scientists, you know, thought of the matter was in three different states, and that was the classification finished. Then they graduated to Mendeleev's idea of chemical elements, which were obtained using systematics of the observed properties of the various objects. This then led to Dalton's idea of atoms. Actually, Dalton's atoms were really molecules. And then the order in atomic weights led to the idea of a proton. So in this stage and age, one would say chemistry and atomic physics were actually the branches of science which dealt with the elementary constituents. And the last step of postulating the proton was actually taken by Rutherford, when he had already discovered the nucleus. So the branch of science that explored the fundamental constituents of matter therefore changed from thermodynamics to chemistry to atomic physics to nuclear physics and now to elementary particle physics. So just before proceeding, I thought I will share a very interesting statement about how important this idea of atoms has been. I mean, why we spend so much time on it, that Democritus had suggested the idea of atom just kind of as a philosophical thing, but we actually were able to, in the 18th century, scientists were actually were able to see and prove that. And just to get an idea how important is the idea of the atoms, a very important famous physicist of the 20th century, Richard Feynman, actually said that if all the scientific knowledge in the world were to be destroyed, and I could choose only one piece of understanding to be passed on to the future so that we can still once again begin a scientific progress and life, I would choose to pass on the message that matter is composed of atoms ceaselessly moving and bouncing against each other. So this particular development, though it which took, you know, happened over a period of a few hundred years, was a very significant development. Now finally, elementary particle physics has actually been, has been the science which has fulfilled Newton's order. What does this subject deal with? It deals with three things. What are the elementary constituents of matter? What holds them together? And more importantly, what is the mathematical framework to describe how these constituents are put together to form matter? How do they interact with each other? And most importantly, how can one predict its behavior under different conditions and test this mathematical framework? So trying to understand the points 2 and 3, particle physicists have learned the importance of symmetry, and that has led to the predictions of new particles which were found in scattering experiments, which in turn fueled the theoretical developments, which in turn fueled some more experimental investigation. And it is this story, some parts of that story, is what we are going to learn today. Now the standard model as of July 4, 2012 is something that all of you have seen again and again. This is the particle content of the standard model and the force carriers. As we know, there are four fundamental interactions, and these four, out of which we are talking right here only of weak, electromagnetic and strong. And these three fundamental interactions are carried by force carriers, which are spin one, out of which W and Z are the weak gauge bosons, which are very massive. Here the Y axis is the mass. So you can see that, and this is a log scale. So you can see that the W bosons are very heavy, Higgs 2 is very heavy, and the Higgs top quark and the W and Z boson are actually sort of sitting here close to each other. The photon and the gluons are sitting at the bottom of the scale, which we cannot see here because it's a logarithmic scale and zero cannot be shown on the scale, but they are all both massless. The neutrinos are actually very light, and that's why the scale is broken here, because this is up to 10 to the minus 4 giga electron volts, and this is much lower, 10 to the minus 22 giga electron volts. So in the neutrinos are very light, as the, whereas the electrons, muons and the tau, which are the spin half objects, which these are also, neutrinos are also spin half objects. So neutrinos and these charged leptons, and they are light, that's why they are leptons. As you can see, the green balls are always the smallest in each generation, are the lowest mass, and then there are these quarks, up, down, charm, strange, top and bottom. So this is the periodic table of the fundamental particles, and this happened on 4th July 2012. So actually Nobel Prize was given in 2013 for this last entry, and I just want to sort of draw your attention to this, that the existence of this particle was actually predicted by Weinberg and Salam in the Unified Model of Electromagnetic and Weak Interactions in 1967. For that, they had used a mechanism which was suggested by Angle, Higgs and Braut how to create masses for the subatomic particles. That mechanism, which was postulated in 1964, was used by Weinberg and Salam in 1967 to predict a particle called the Higgs boson. The machine planning began in 1986, and the existence of this Higgs boson was confirmed in 1999 indirectly. But in between, in all these years, a gigantic collider called the Large Hadron Collider was built. There were two gigantic experiments, which were ATLAS and CMS, and through a collaboration of thousands of experimental physicists as well as theoretical physicists, one was able to finally discover this object in 2012. So hunting the Higgs was a major, major expedition. So you can ask first this question, was it always so for all the particles? Because if that was the case, then we are really, you know, you should really admire particle physicists that they have found all these particles through such big, big expeditions. Actually, that's not quite true. Some of them particles actually came to the party by themselves. They were accidentally discovered, but some were predicted. But the hunt was perhaps not necessarily so difficult or so expensive. And it is this journey that I want to try to follow to some extent and try to show you how different ideas, theoretical ideas, and the experimental progresses actually were combinedly responsible for us arriving at this end station. So along the way, actually, in this journey, we discovered some objects which we thought at that time were elementary, but then we discovered they were composites. And these were what I would call the intermediate stops on the trains of knowledge in this, of the train of knowledge in this journey. So how long was this journey in terms of time? There is a lot of information in this slide, and I'm not going to discuss it because I am going to take it along one by one as we go through, and I'm going to discuss some members of this table. But what I want to show you is that these three tables, these give you a history of leptons, history of discovery of quarks, and history of the discovery of the force carrier bosons. And the first lepton to be discovered was in 1897 by Thomson, the electron, but it was postulated based on some patterns in 1894 by Stoney. On the other hand, the positron, its positively charged partner of the electron, was actually predicted by Dirac by saying that the theory of relativity predicts that if there exists a particle like an electron, a spin-half particle, one must have a spin-half particle of the same mass, but which is positively charged. And lo and behold, in 1932, it was actually discovered. I will talk about the discoveries of nu e and nu mu to some extent, so I will not spend time here. But here you can see that the nu e was postulated, but discovered in 1956. The nu mu was postulated in 48 and discovered only in 1962. But now when you, on the other hand, in the table of quarks, you see that UDS, like the electron, was postulated in 1894. The up, down, and strange quarks were postulated in 1964, discovered in 1969. Now when you go through the tables, you will realize that as we are going to the discovery of the bosons, you realize that the massive bosons, the W plus minus, the Z, and the Higgs, actually were postulated in the 1964 or 1967, but they were discovered so very late. Sorry, this is a typo. This is not 2005. This is 1905. Photon was discovered in 1905. But what I want to focus on is that the discoveries of these heavier objects, you find that there was a big gap, bigger gaps between the postulation, the indirect information, and the discovery. Okay, in this journey, we actually had very many intermediate stops, and one of them was the nucleus, which was discovered by Rutherford in alpha particle scattering. And I think this was really the beginning of the inward bound journey into the heart of the matter. Pions, which were predicted by Yukawa in 1935 as force carriers between a neutron and a proton, and they were found in cosmic ray experiments in 1947. And the existence of the protons was inferred from observations patterns in the atomic weights, etc. And the neutron's existence was inferred from properties of nuclei. And actually, neutron was discovered in 1932 when it was predicted. I don't have it here. Predicted around 1915 or 18. So at these intermediary points in the journey, these objects were actually considered point-like. So let us see about the electron. The electron actually was postulated by sort of indications of electrons were seen by Faraday in the second half of the 19th century, where he realized that electricity also comes in multiples of a basic unit, just like the photon energy comes. Anyway, let me not go into it. So he actually found this, that the electricity comes in multiples of basic unit. And then the experiments with cathode rays by Thomson, and this is the famous experiment that he did. And in fact, Thomson could see that cathode rays were made up of what he called corpuscles. And those are the ones which had a E by M ratio, which was very different from the only other lightest particle that was known at that time, namely the hydrogen ion. So this electron was actually the first elementary particle to be discovered. And in this discovery of the electron, Thomson had actually, in this discovery, the world of elementary particles of today was actually born. Let me try to summarize three things. There were three basic properties in the transition from electron being a postulated entity to a physical reality. And they were like, this took about 4-5 years. The first step was observation by Faraday that the electricity comes in units from patterns in ionization. The experiments made by Thomson that cathode rays behave under the action of electric and magnetic fields as though they consisted of a set of particles and not a wave. Further, he could determine the ratio of charge to the mass, the famous E by M, which was quite different by a factor of about 2000 from the hydrogen ion. But that was not all. Lorentz actually calculated splitting of the atomic spectral lines in magnetic field. And the prediction of the splitting that he had computed agreed with what Zeeman had measured only if the E by M of the electron inside the atom was the same as that measured by Thomson. So this actually proved that the corpuscle that was seen by Thomson in his cathode ray tube was the same as the electron that exists in an atom. So this is where the electron, from being an entity which was postulated by Stoney, became a physical reality when confirmed as a physical reality. Now, Thomson had gone ahead and also made a plum pudding model of atom, where he thought that the electrons were sticking up like plumes in a cake. Whereas Rutherford didn't have any ideas, but he just wanted to check by scattering alpha particles from a thin gold foil. So this was his experiment. There were alpha particle source which was put here, and alpha particles were being emitted, and he put a thin gold foil in the path of the alpha rays, and then looked at the alpha rays that were coming here, hitting this zinc sulfide screen, and looked at the light scintillations that were emitted after the alpha particles hit the zinc sulfide screen. And this was observed in a darkened room with a microscope. So the microscope and the zinc sulfide screen made a detector. Thin gold foil was the target, and this was the beam. And this arrangement has not changed since then. Now, this particular detector arrangement was very nice because it could be moved all around, behind the thin gold foil, in front of the thin gold foil, and all around the place. And what they found? They counted the number of alpha particles which were scattered from the gold foil at different angles. And what they found that the most of the alpha particles actually went undeflected, but some rebounded and came back. And this was completely opposite that to what expected if the Planck pudding model was true. Let me try to go on the next slide and explain it. But Rutherford concluded from this observation that the atom was a lot of open free space, except some charge which was concentrated at one point. And that is what meant, that is why most of the alpha particles went undeflected. They saw nothing to deflect them. And therefore, I would say that Rutherford truly split the atom into nucleus and the electrons. Now, what does it mean? Why does this observation meant that the positive charge of the atom was concentrated at a point, which he called the nucleus? Now, this happened because, just think of an example. I'll give an example. Supposing we are thinking of a person crossing the road, the two sides of the road. The person is trying to cross the road, and there is a big knot of people, which is, there is an accident and people are circling around that knot. Now, if the person tries to go through the knot, he or she will be pushed back, will not be able to cross the road. On the other hand, if he or she goes around it, then they will be able to cross the road. So if the alpha particle didn't hit the central knot, the central point where the charge was concentrated, then the alpha particles would go undeflected. But when they hit it, they will be repelled, they will be pushed back. So that was the idea. Now, how do you know, this is why Rutherford kind of said that it was about as credible as if you had fired a 15-inch shell at a piece of tissue paper and it came back and hit you. But how did this, not just this qualitative understanding, but one can actually use the results that were given by Rutherford to make a more quantitative statement and more in such experiments. And the alpha particles can actually look inside the atom to see the size of the region which contained the positive charge. And what the alpha particles saw, that the size of the region containing the positive charge was an extremely small part of the total space in the atom. So this is more pictoriously, let me draw it here, sort of picturesquely, let me draw it here, that these are the alpha particles going, and the alpha particles which are going far away will actually not be deflected very much, but the alpha particle which comes head on, impact parameter zero, will be directly pushed back. And other words of saying it is that because one knew that there is an electromagnetic interaction, electrostatic repulsion between the alpha particle and the positively charged nucleus, one can actually compute how many alpha particles should appear at a particular angle. And if the atom didn't have a substructure, that means if the atom was as a whole a body point-like, then what would you have expected? You would have expected that at large angles there was very little scattering. You can compute a formula, you can do this calculation. Rutherford actually does this calculation in his paper. But what you found is that the number of alpha particles scattered at large angle was much, much bigger than what is expected if the atom was charged uniformly, the charge was uniformly distributed in the atom. So this is where you realize that the atom had a substructure and a charge of the atom was concentrated at one point. So in fact, actually one can take this to one's knowledge further, that apart from Rutherford's experiment, if I have some other experiment and if I have some other scattering by a particle which interacts with the target through some interaction, all I do is calculate the distribution of the counts as a function of the scattering angle and compare it with that expected from a point target. And if they differ, you know that the target has a substructure. And in fact, the modification then can be used to extract information about the size of the target. Now here, please let us take a pause and realize that the existence of atom is inferred from many properties of matter on macroscopic scales, as by Dalton and Mendeleev and so on and so forth. But for the nucleus, the first indication of its existence actually came from scattering experiments. And if you were in 1914, the worldview would have been that everything is made up of molecules, which are made up of atoms. Atoms contain electrons with a lot of empty space and positively charged point nuclei. So this was the decade of atomic physics and nuclear physics. But were the nuclei then the elementary building blocks? Nuclei seem to transform spontaneously into one another, belying the expectation that the nuclei can be elementary building blocks. And actually the discovery of radioactivity, which happens naturally, played a very big role in this period. But one also found in the experiments following the discovery of the nucleus, again in Cavendish laboratory, that the masses of the nuclei were approximate integral multiples of the mass of the hydrogen nucleus. So maybe the hydrogen nucleus was the basic building block. So this began the decade of nuclear physics. If the nucleus is made, but you know, before I proceed further, some of you should have asked me this question, that if the nucleus, you are telling us that the nucleus is made up of nucleons, and that is the neutrons and the protons, and the neutrons and protons are made up of quarks, so why did Rutherford see the nucleus as a point? Why did he not see that as an extended charge distribution? So now to understand this, we have to realize how we measure sizes of objects. How do we resolve them into their constituents? Microscopes were used to see things, right? We see them all the time. You increase the knob, turn the knob of a microscope, and suddenly, lo and behold, a cell, you take a small section of a stem of a tree or a stem of a whatever little plant, and you start seeing the cells, actually, right? And then you see the nucleus of the cell if you really have a good microscope. Now, how do you have a good microscope? That means a good microscope with higher resolving power, which is able to resolve two points as two separate points. Now, a higher resolving power requires small wavelengths and hence higher energy of the light beam. Now, we knew that photons behaved like a wave as well as a particle. This was thanks to Einstein. We realized this in 1905. And then de Broglie actually used that to postulate that same must be true for an electron. There is no difference between one particle photon and another particle electron. It's just that the energies at which the electron looks like a wave are very, very large, because the wavelength is given by this very small constant called Planck's constant, which is extremely small, divided by 2 pi times the momentum of the electron. So only when the momentum of the electron starts becoming larger, then we start getting the wave, some results, some implications of the wave nature of the electron are found. But here, higher the energy, smaller the wavelength. So one can use high energy particles to see smaller things. And Rutherford used alpha particles to look inside the atom. His alpha particles had energy of the order of million electron volts. Therefore, the wavelength was of the order of 100th of an angstrom. You can use this formula and do this small calculation. It could therefore resolve atom into nucleus and electrons. But however, the nuclear size is smaller than this power of resolution, as a result of which the nucleus of a size which has a size much smaller than the 100 angstrom seen to Rutherford just as a point. So Rutherford saw the nucleus as a point because he had beams of rather low energy. In fact, Rutherford himself lamented the lack of high energy beams when he said that it has been long been my ambition to have available a copious supply of atoms and electrons which will have energy transcending those of the alpha and beta particles. In fact, following the order, again in Cavendish lab, protons and electrons were accelerated to high energies, beginning from the accelerators which were built by Cockcroft and Walton, on whom this lecture is named when this is given in India, Cockcroft-Walton lecture, and Van de Graaff, and so on and so forth. So the development in high energy physics actually went hand in hand with the development in accelerating particles to higher and higher energies. We had two types of accelerators. One was the one where the man-made accelerators, and these are the humble beginnings of the man-made accelerators. This is the first Cockcroft-Walton accelerator which fitted inside a room. Compare that with the Large Hadron Collider, which now which is a ring where the radius, the diameter of the circumference of the circle is about 27 kilometers. And the first cyclotron was actually only 4.5 inches, which accelerated the particle to 1 million electron volts. This was made by Lawrence and Livingston in 1933. Accelerators moved along a lot in the 100 years. And let me come back from this small digression, and let me continue the thought about what happened now that we had seen that the nucleus, the world of nuclear physics, the subject of nuclear physics started developing. And the study of nuclei actually told you that there were patterns in the nuclear masses, there were patterns in the spin angular momenta, and that actually almost immediately told that nuclei are made up of smaller units, and those smaller units were protons and neutrons, both of which were actually theorized by Rutherford. And at that time, you know, the fundamental objects would have been the photon, the electron, the proton, and the neutron, and one more, the neutrino. This was because the nuclear beta decays, again the study of nuclei, nuclear beta decays, one had seen that effectively a proton converts into a neutron or vice versa, and a positron and an electron is emitted. And free neutron had been discovered by Chadwick in 1936, which also decayed. And it decayed, and it was found to have two decay products, proton and electron, nothing wrong with it. But then the electron energy seemed to vary continuously in this decay as well as in the nuclear beta decay. And that meant that somehow the energy was not conserved. So also linear momentum was not conserved and the angular momentum was not conserved. All this could be seen only because people had made good measurements of the spin angular momenta, as well as the energy levels of the different nuclei. So because of that, they were able to draw this conclusion. And neutrino, the small neutron, was postulated by Pauli in desperation because he wanted to preserve the conservation of energy angular momentum in nuclear beta decay, and also Pauli's exclusion principle, in fact. And all these conservation laws, or all these like Pauli's exclusion principle, are actually related to issues of symmetry. And for example, conservation of linear momentum is related to the fact that laws of physics do not depend on the position where the experiment is performed. So this actually, I would say, the introduction of neutrino was the example of an invariance or a symmetry idea being used to posit the existence of a new particle, and we are going to see it again and again and again. And this is slightly different from the prediction of the positron by Dirac. This is a little bit different because here you're using the piece of experimental information, namely that there is an apparent energy, momentum, angular momentum, lack of conservation of energy and momentum in the neutron decay or in the beta decay. So this whole story is to repeat again and again. So by this time, when you saw that nuclei were decaying, neutron itself was decaying, now one knew that the neutrons and protons or the nucleus itself is certainly not an elementary object. If the neutron decays, then the neutron is most probably also not an elementary object. And the nucleus is a composite of protons and neutrons was already understood by the observation of patterns in the properties of nuclei. Also, neutrons and protons were observed outside the nucleus. You could ask the question, why is it, since the electrons seem to be coming out in the beta decay here, sorry, there should have been a plus an electron. So why don't you think that the electron was inside the nucleus? And that is something that was understood by Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, that the energy of the electrons which come out in beta decays are about a few MeV, and therefore they could not have existed inside the nucleus before the decay, and hence they could not be constituents of the nucleus. So you see the interplay of theory and observations again and again playing an important role. Now, protons, you know, let's come to the next level now, protons and neutrons. Now, here what I want to talk about is that at this point, one had realized that neutron decays, so, you know, neutron is not stable, but on the other hand, inside a nucleus, the neutron seems to remain without decaying. So, is it that the world is made up of protons and neutrons, and the electron, and the photon, and the neutrino? At that time, this was the first idea, theoretical progress of an introduction of an idea of an internal symmetry, which actually controlled and propelled the development in theoretical particle physics for decades. So let me just spend a few minutes in trying to explain the idea of this internal symmetry. This was the idea that was introduced by Heisenberg. So proton and neutrons have very similar masses, all nuclei are formed with them, and both seem to have spin half. One, on top of it, from the study of properties of mirror nuclei, one knew that the proton-proton, proton-neutron and neutron-neutron forces in nuclei are very similar to each other in strength and range. People had also done the experiments with proton-proton scattering and proton-neutron scattering. And therefore, they made a hypothesis that one can imagine the proton and neutron as two states of a particle, which they would call a nucleon. So the nucleon is with an internal spin in the up direction with a projection half would be a proton, and a nucleon with the internal spin, which is called I spin, in the down direction would be a neutron. So proton and neutron are nothing but two states of this nucleon with spin up in the internal spin direction, isospin down in this internal spin direction. Now, we know all that a rotation in real space can change the state of an electron with spin along the plus z-axis to a state with spin along the negative z-axis. Because supposing I have the xyz, I don't know if you can see my hands, but supposing I have this as the z-axis, this as the x-axis, and this as the y-axis, now I can make a rotation around the y-axis such that what was positive z-direction will become the negative z-direction in the new choice of coordinates. And under this rotation, a state of an electron which had a spin along the positive z-axis now actually will have a spin projection along the negative z-axis. Now, in the presence of only an electrostatic potential, we cannot actually detect the difference between the electron with spin up and electron with spin down. And this has to do with the fact that the electrostatic potential actually is a function only of the modulus of the distance and not of the vector. And therefore, the potential is actually unchanged under a rotation of the coordinate axis. You all know this, that if I have a three coordinate axis and I make a rotation, the distance of the point from the origin remains the same. It is still r. So a rotation in the hypothetical internal space converts a nucleon in the spin up state into a nucleon in a spin down state. And if there is isospin rotation invariance, if the interaction between the nucleons is invariant under this rotation in the internal space rotation, then the interaction among two protons or two neutrons or a neutron and a proton will be the same. And that is what experimentally had been seen. Therefore, he made an hypothesis that there is a symmetry in this internal space direction. And this was the first internal symmetry that was postulated, and it was found to be true by the nucleus, found to be valid for nuclear forces. Now, simultaneously, there was a discovery of a zoo of particles in cosmic ray experiments, which were the natural accelerators, and in the accelerator experiments, mostly which were housed at that time in the US. And large number of particles, which were just like the proton and neutron, but bit heavier, had spin half, had spin three half, had charges of different varieties. So now one began to wonder, all of these cannot be fundamental. And then came Gell-Mann, Zweig, you know, separately, actually, and they presented an extension of this I-spin idea, which was by then supported by a lot of data in nuclear physics. And they actually proposed that all the heavy particles which were being discovered in these cosmic rays in the accelerator experiments, which looked like neutrons and protons, one of them was called lambda, another one was some sigma, so on and so forth. And these heavy particles, they were called baryons, then there were the Yukawa's pi mesons, then so on and so forth, K mesons, which were also found in cosmic ray experiments. And then Gell-Mann and Zweig presented an idea that the three types of quarks, up, down, and strange, and all the heavy spin half objects, which were called baryons, and the heavier spin zero objects, which were the mesons, pi plus, pi minus, pi naught, k zero, they are made up of these three types of quarks. This is how the idea of the UDS quarks arrived. And their observation basically said that the pattern and the regularity which is exhibited in the properties of the members of the particle zoo reduce the number of fundamental constituents varies to a large small number. Those were the quarks. But nobody could break the proton and neutrons into quarks. Remember, in the case of nucleus, there was no problem. We found that the nuclei transmitted into each other, and neutrons and protons were coming out of the nuclei, or alpha particles were coming out. So you knew that nuclei were made up of nucleons. You could see that very easily. But here, you could not break up a proton and a neutron into quarks. So people decided that maybe quarks were not real entities, but some kind of mathematical abstraction. And actually, this idea was even further supported because you needed the quarks to have fractional electrical charges, one third or two third the charge of an electron. People looked for fractionally charged objects in experiments. None were found. So many, many physicists just decided that quarks are abstract entities. They are only postulated. In terms of this, we can understand the observed patterns. They don't have to be really there. They don't have to exist. And just like the chemists of 19th century who had decided that atoms and molecules were a good idea to explain the kinetic theory and the gas laws, but they were really not real. And people really had to wait finally to get a proof of atoms in the for Einstein when he talked of Brownian motion. Actually, they were completely justified in disbelieving quarks because they needed to come in three different varieties called color so that there will be no clash with Pauli's exclusion principle. So this was actually even the paper that was written by Gell-Mann adds only in the end that maybe we should not neglect the idea that these could be really real entities. But that he comes only at the last line of his paper. But what he did, that using this idea, he actually predicted the existence and the mass of a particle called omega. And it was actually confirmed experimentally, and he got the Nobel Prize. And this at least said that the idea of the symmetry was correct. But then people said, where are the quarks? Can you do a Rutherford type of experiment to see them? Why do they not appear free in space? Can we see if we hit our proton with a very high energy? How can you break the proton? Now, this is the first time you have a difference from the case of nuclei and nucleons here. And I will now skip this because I'm running short on time. So I was going to explain the general philosophy by which we have arrived at the structure of matter. And if time is left, I would come back to this. So people decided to do an experiment, which is a more nucleus or proton version of Rutherford scattering experiment. And this was done at Stanford Linear Accelerator. This was a 2 mile long accelerator, which accelerated electrons to an unprecedented energy at that time of 2000 electron volts, 20 giga electron volts, and 20 giga electron volts is 20,000 million electron volts. So they could produce this electron energy, and this was hit on a target either as a nucleus or a proton, and in the detector they saw the scattered electron. Very similar to Rutherford experiment, instead of the alpha particle, the beam was electron, and the wavelength of the electron was about 1000 to 10,000 times smaller than the wavelength of the alpha particle. You can do the computation, and then you compute the electron, count the number of electrons which are scattered at an angle theta, and compare them with the prediction for a point nucleus or a point proton. So this was the experiment, this was the mile long accelerator, this was the detector. Now you see the small, simple arrangement in Rutherford's experiment has been replaced by a much more gigantic experiment. Here is a person in relation with this spectrometer, which is looking at detecting the electrons, and the spectrometer could be moved very slowly. So the angles, only very finite numbers of angles were chosen to collect the data. But lo and behold, this showed you that by arguments very similar to those calculations, very similar to those which were used in the case of Rutherford, that the nucleus and the proton also have a finite size. And the ratio with expectations with a point nucleus and point proton, one could use that to calculate what was the size of this target. And one found that the nuclei were about 10,000 to 100,000 times smaller than the atoms. And indeed, that could, therefore, they could be seen, because now the wavelength of these was about 10,000 to 10,000 times smaller. And therefore, they were able to, these electrons were able to see the nucleus, not as a point, but as an extended object. And this this was expected, that okay, a nucleus consisted of nucleons, so you better have a finite size. But what about the proton? Now, the interaction of a charged particle, here I have to explain one small thing, that the interaction of a charged particle with magnetic field is decided by its magnetic moment. And the ratio of magnetic moment to the spin is called the gyromagnetic ratio. Now, it was known that the proton has a gyromagnetic ratio of about 2.75. According to Dirac's equation, a spin half point particle should have a value for gyromagnetic ratio to be 2.0. So this actually tells you already that the proton is not point-like. A neutron, which is neutral, should have no magnetic moment according to Dirac's ideas, but it did. So this had already told us that the proton and neutron must be at least charge distributions. Now, can we get the information on the spatial extent of these distributions? So Hofstadter actually studied this reaction, where he had an electron of energy, let me call it EEE, and it is incident on a proton. And again, he observed an electron and measured the energy of the scattered electron, let's just call it E prime. And you can actually do a small calculation of kinematics, conservation of energy and momentum. And it tells you that for a given value of the energy of the incident electron and a scattering angle theta, there will be only one fixed value of the scattered electron. So therefore, you can measure the energy of the scattered electron at a fixed angle theta, and then if the energy is equal to what you had computed from this, then the then you are really measuring this reaction. And using this reaction, they were again able to see that the proton has a finite size, and that size is 100,000 times smaller than an atom, and it's about a fermion. So this actually confirmed the inference that people had already got from the measurements of static properties. But now came the surprise, and that's where we are going to end this story, is that a surprise came when the electron energy was increased even further. When the electron energy was further increased from 2 GeV to 20 GeV and further, the resolution now decreased to about 100 the time of the size of the proton and the neutron. And now what one found is that here the E prime for a fixed angle was fixed. But here you suddenly started finding electrons of different energies at a fixed angle. They started telling them that at higher energies, they were getting scattered of something else inside the proton. And when they increased the value of the energy E even further, Then suddenly the scattered electron started seeing a unique value of scattered electron, again started having a unique value, something called, which I will denote by E prime 0, but it was different than the value that it had when the electron was scattering off the proton. So when the electron was scattering off the proton and producing a proton, it had an energy which I called here E prime E, and at the high values of energy, the scattered electron now again started having a fixed value of scattered energy, but it was a different value of the scattered energy. And at this point, the lambda E was small enough to see the individual presence of the individual scatterers inside the proton. This is what people understood. And then you could use the exact value at of E naught prime to extract the number of these individual scatterers inside the proton. And lo and behold, it was found to be exactly 3. This is how the existence of elementary quarks was revealed inside the composite proton, just like the Rutherford's large angle scattering revealed the existence of the point-like nucleus inside the atom. And this is what Gell-Mann's model needed. It needed 3 quarks inside the proton, and indeed the quarks made a second coming. Then they started measuring the electron energies for different angles and different incoming energies, so scattered electron energies for at different angles and for different incoming electron energies, and they could actually determine the spin of the scatterers, and they found that the spin of the scatterers was half, exactly like Gell-Mann's model needed it. It had all the other properties that were required by Gell-Mann's model, even the funny charges of 2/3 and 1/3 the electron charge. So now the scattering experiments substantiated the conclusions which were drawn from observing the patterns or the symmetries. But they actually did something more, and that is why I have included this discussion here. The same experiments also showed that there existed scatterers inside the proton which were invisible to the electron because they were neutral. In fact, the theory of strong interactions being developed around the same time, such neutral force carriers called gluons were actually indicated. So here the experiments are indicating that there exists in the proton some neutral component, and here the theory also says that maybe there are some these force carriers which could be present inside the proton. And now by making very detailed measurements over decades of the number of scattered electrons with different energies at different angles, we have seen that it is completely consistent with the predictions of the theory which is called quantum chromodynamics. But this particular observation was actually, which happened in 1972 or 1974, around there, this was the first glimpse of the gluons and the first clue as to what is the correct theory of strong interaction, and got the Nobel Prize for Physics in 2004, although the theory was put forward in 1974, because it took those 30 odd years to do the experiments carefully to prove that this was indeed the correct theory. So please see the interplay between theory and experiments. And this is just to show you that there are 10 orders of magnitude of the data. There are 6 orders of magnitude of some variable connected to energy. Another 6 orders of magnitude of this observable, which I called X. And the measurements are here. And all these measurements actually are in complete agreement with the predictions of the theory of quantum chromodynamics. Now, if you increase the energy further, then what one found is that the number of constituents goes on increasing. That means the number of quarks and gluons are created sort of dynamically inside the proton as you try to probe it with higher and higher energies, but the type of constituents doesn't change. And the total number of quarks remains 3, that in a proton. That is total number of quarks minus the total number of antiquarks. You have exactly 3 quarks left at the end of the day. And the increasing energies do not reveal any new constituents, but reveal only the increasing number of known constituents, namely quarks and gluons, which was in a manner which is completely consistent with the predictions of the theory of interactions between quarks and gluons. And at present, the experiments with the highest energy, which is what I have shown you here, correspond to an electron beam energy of 100 billion electron volts. there is a complications here which I will not go into. You don't really need to accelerate electrons to 100 billion electron volts, but we'll leave that for a later discussion. But we have not found any structure inside a quark up to a distance scale of 1000th Fermi. And the limit is only there because we are limited what is our resolving power by the energy that we can produce. So now I come to the end of this, my discussion. Is this the end of road in substructure? We actually think so. Now, are we saying this simply because we don't have high enough energy probes? The answer is no. This is where the dynamics that I talked about comes into play with full strength. Scattering, or equivalently what I call seeing of the constituents, is only one way in which we hunt for what is at the heart of the matter. At present, every other single piece of experimental observation agrees to a very high degree of accuracy, better than to one part in a 100 million, part in a 100 million at times for the measurement of gyromagnetic ratio of the muon and the gyromagnetic ratio of the electron, with the prediction of the theory which treats these quarks and leptons as point-like in all the calculations up to the highest imaginable energy. So we have an indirect but extremely strong proof that the quarks and leptons are indeed point-like and have no further substructure. Now, once you have an understanding of the dynamics of the fundamental constituents, that is the interactions among them, we can perform high energy experiments where they scatter off each other, and then they shed light on how they interact with each other, how, for example, they can collide and produce a Higgs boson, and so on and so forth. And that is the part of what the LHC is doing. Now, what has happened is that I have talked about only one track of the journey of particle physicists, which they did, asking questions of what are the ultimate constituents of matter. And I actually covered only the electron, positron, mu plus, mu minus, nu e, nu mu, uds, quarks, and the photon. I didn't tell you the story of the discovery of the rest of the quarks, the charm, bottom, and top, the leptons, tau and nu tau, the heavier force carriers, w and z, the massless gluons I alluded to, and the spinless Higgs. This is a long story. I won't have time to do that now, but this is where our development of mathematical framework, which I called, comes into play in a very, very serious way. And in fact, the existence of the heavy gauge bosons W and Z and the Higgs boson were predicted in the standard model in the theoretical development. And only the masses of the W and Z were, only for the W and Z, the masses were predicted. And the experiments discovered them with the right mass and the right couplings to the matter. Experiments were constructed just to look at them, look for them. And that's where this entire long period was required, first to understand what their masses where, because the masses were predicted in terms of quantities which had to be accurately measured in experiments. So this was a long journey because of that. The heavier quarks, the charm quark, was predicted at that time in 1974, but the actual discovery when it happened was a bit accidental. But discovery of the charm quark threw open the development, pushed the development of standard model on a fast lane, and this is what is called November Revolution. The B and the tau were really not required, were not predicted. But once you found the B and the tau, just like the mu, the B and the tau also came for the ride. They just came. But once they were found unlooked for, top quark had to exist and its mass was actually predicted. So again, a lot of effort was put in building colliders such that we can find the top quark. And mind you, in building those colliders and making those predictions, you needed the knowledge of what is the quark content inside a proton, and that is what gluon content, and that was used very critically in making all these predictions. So this is the part of the journey which is very different to explain and complicated to explain. I am not going to do that, but the Higgs was actually predicted existent, but not its mass. The theory had given, all theories were not very smart, we could only give limits, but the measurements of the properties of the Z boson at an experiments which were done at the Large Electron Positron Collider, LHC, provided indirect estimates of mass, of its mass, and indeed the Large Hadron Collider found the Higgs at precisely that mass with all the right properties, and that was the crowning success of the standard model. So now you say, is this the end of the road? Far from it. The journey is not over, And we don't say it simply because we want to keep ourselves in business, but we say it because we have these puzzles. The dark matter in the universe, the matter, antimatter, and asymmetry in the universe, the acceleration of the universe. And for particle physicists like me, we want to explain why the Higgs is light. We want to explain the non-zero mass of the neutrino, and so on and so forth. So the journey still goes on, except now the experiments, both the experiments in the sky and the experiments on the earth and underground, all have to play together to probe these wonders of nature. And that's where the game is on now. I've just produced for fun the photograph of the sun as seen in the photon, that is this, and as seen in the neutrinos, that is this. So multi-wavelength spectroscopy, multi-wavelength probing the universe through a wavelength or different types of waves, the gravitational waves, the neutrinos, the light, and what have you, is the name of the game. And I think we are all looking at, towards this adventure with great gusto. Thank you very much, and apologies for running over time by 5 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was an absolutely fascinating lecture, Rohini. If I may, I would really enjoy taking chair's privilege on this and asking a little question to start with myself. You told us a little bit about the force carriers and how they fitted in. I would really love to hear a little bit more about that, how their discovery and the experiments, their masses, how the interactions were probed. Could you tell us a little bit about that? And I see we have a few questions that are relating to the force carriers as well. Okay. So hopefully it will be a nice...
No, thank you very much, actually, because these are all in my backup.
Oh.
I knew I won't be able to cover them, but I was hoping that I would use them to give precisely convey the information. So if I may, can I share my slides again?
Oh, please do.
Okay. Because I think finally, you know, for me, I wanted to make it a two-step story. One-step story is that you keep on going in, and even that peering in, increasing the power of your microscope, how deep can you go in?
Yeah.
I mean, that is sort of traditional way of finding what is inside.
Indeed.
And then the other interesting point that I wanted to bring out was the interplay between what we know already theoretically. And in this new game, the third part, which I didn't have time and which is what your question is asking me to elaborate upon, is where the earlier experiment and our theories set a target. So it was like, you know, setting the, you have this high jump and you keep on pushing the bar up and up and up, you know, the Olympic game of high jump. And the theorists kept on moving the bar up and up to higher and higher energies and finding things that were more and more difficult to look for, and the experimentalists did fantastic things. So let me just share that, because I am myself completely impressed with that part of particle physics. Let me just share it in a minute. As I said, it is in my backup, so you can see. Okay. So the point is that to make that statement, let me begin very briefly by saying that when all this was happening, you know, I mean, when I talked about discovery of quarks and discovery of Gell-Mann quarks, etc., there were many, many things were happening in the world of particle physics. And I only talked about how you can probe it by going to higher and higher energy probes. But at the same time, people were developing understanding of these dynamics. And that is finding the mathematical framework which describes these interactions among these fundamental blocks, which then makes it and forms the whole. Now, in fact, what happened was it began with the formulation of what we call quantum electrodynamics, QED. And this was done by Tomanaga, Feynman, and Schwinger. They got a Nobel Prize for that. And I think this introduced the first important idea that in the field, you know, we were used to understanding the potential between two charges, as there is this charge Q1, it produces the field lines, and then there is this charge Q2, and then it feels the force, which is normal to the field lines, which means that it is along the line joining the two charges, and the potential energy is Q1, Q2 by R. because Q1 by R is the field and Q2 is the potential energy per unit. Q1 by R is the potential energy per unit charge and Q2 is the charge. So total potential energy Q1, Q2 by R. But what the development of 20th century theoretical particle physics has been is to understand that this picture is completely equivalent to this another picture where we say that the charge Q1, there is a particle with charge Q1, which actually emits a photon. That photon lives for a very short amount of time till it goes and gets absorbed by the second charge Q2. And if you calculate this amplitude using the rules of quantum electrodynamics, and then you take the limit where, some appropriate limits you have to take, and you can show that this picture are completely equivalent, because here we find that the potential energy of these two charges is Q1, Q2 by R. And here also, by the rules of quantum field theory, I can derive that the potential energy of these two charges together is Q1, Q2 by R. What is required to get this 1 by R is that the mass of the photon should be zero, and that also corresponds to its infinite range. And this was actually completely nicely proved, and that is where these people got their Nobel Prize. Now, one said that if this is so nicely, electromagnetic interactions are so nicely expressed in terms of a quantum field theory, which has this very special properties, which makes the mass of the photon to be zero, and they are called gauge field theories. So now one said, can we not describe all the other interactions as gauge field theories? And our Indian physicist E.C.G. Sudarshan and his advisor, PhD advisor Marshak, again the famous Nobel Prize winners Feynman and Gell-Mann, as well as another Nobel Prize winner, Schwinger, the same Schwinger who gave you the theory of quantum theory of electromagnetic interaction. These people actually laid, the bricks, foundations for developing weak theory, gauge field theory of weak interactions. And the general idea was that just like the photon is a carrier of electromagnetic interactions, the carrier of the weak interaction will be a weak analog of the photon, and Schwinger actually called it W, weak boson. That's what it called it. But now there was a real problem, because photon had zero mass and it had played an essential role in being able to describe the interactions which are mediated by the photon description in terms of a gauge field theory. Now the short range of the weak interactions, because they applied only within a nucleus, meant that the force carrier was not massless. And in fact, the potential between these two, this fermion and this fermion, the potential will be actually e to the minus mr by r. And if m is large, then this would mean that at large distances, this is damped, exponentially damped, and it's a short range potential. But once you have this non-zero mass, people didn't know how to write a quantum field theory which will make sense at high energies. And this is where the Sheldon Glashow, Peter Riggs, Abdul Salam, and Steven Weinberg, the work done by them at different times and separately, all of this helped in sorting this mess out. And in 67, we had a model of leptons, which was unified description of electromagnetic and weak interactions, where the photon is massless and the W boson it's massive. In fact, the standard model as we know it today is nothing but this model of leptons put forward by Weinberg, which is extended to include the quarks and the strong interactions. But now let me go back to the predictions of Weinberg's paper. It's a beautiful paper. So first, it predicts existence of a heavy counterpart of the photon, that means neutral object, which would mediate new types of weak interactions, and they were called the neutral current interactions. And further, the masses of the W and the Z, and also the interactions of the Z bosons with the leptons, were predicted in terms of just the electric charge E and a parameter, which was an arbitrary parameter called theta, which we call it now theta weak. In the early days, it used to be called theta Weinberg. And then the discovery of this new type of interactions in 1974, mind you, the same year when the charm quark was discovered. And further, in the few years since then, in 3 years, one found that the strengths of these weak interactions are exactly as predicted by Weinberg's model in this step two. And then that was enough for the Nobel Prize to be given to all the three heroes, even though the W and the Z were not discovered at that time, because we didn't have enough energy to produce them. But people were convinced that the W's and the Z's must exist. And this is the theoretical prediction of the W and the Z. And then that led, for example, to, you know, finally to this Lagrangian, which right now is written on the back of a t-shirt, which you can buy at CERN. And then led the entire experimental expedition, making a special collider, SPP bar S, that it was called P bar P collider. Rubia and Vandermeer got a Nobel Prize for that. And they built that collider just to make the W's and the Z's. And that happened in 1984. And this is what I meant, that the masses of the W and the Z were predicted, and they were discovered at the predicted mass with the right couplings to the matter in 1983. Then people's belief in the Higgs boson went even higher. But the Higgs boson was a more difficult character because the theory could not predict its mass ab initio. But just like the W and the Z masses were predicted in terms of one particular measured object called sine theta W, the Higgs mass was predicted in terms of few measured parameters, and that is what was done at LHC. And indeed, we knew that the Higgs would exist somewhere around 100 to 200 giga electron volt mass, and then the rest is history, as they say. So thanks, Melissa, for giving me this opportunity to share this exciting part of the story.
Thank you. Thank you very much for sharing. That's obviously with my neutrino interest, the hearing about the W and Z is always very, very close to my heart. And in fact, measuring different parameters in the W and Z is what allowed us to understand that there are three types of neutrino in the standard model. So, and this leads me on to more questions that I have for you, but I am going to stop and I'm going to hand over to our fantastic audience who have a number of questions of their own. So still on the subject of force carriers, if gluons are massless, how is it that the strong force has a short range?
That is a very good question. I mean, when I give a talk only on the force carriers, I actually spend a whole lot of time on that. I fully expected this question and I congratulate the person on the question. The gluons, the force that is exchanged by the gluons is in fact has a 1 by r form at very high energies. But at low energies, the potential between two gluons, the two quarks, which is mediated by the gluons, is actually proportional to the logarithm of the distance between them. And this has to do with an extremely interesting property of the theory of quantum chromodynamics. But the simple way of understanding it would be, let me just take a rubber string, okay? And if it is lying, you know, here on this table, doing nothing, then it is lame. It has no energy in it. I pick it up, I try to separate the two ends, and then there is tension. So this, the thing with the interaction between the two quarks is a bit like that. And that has to do with the mathematical property that, and this is a bit difficult to explain without going into a formula. But let me try nonetheless. See, we are all familiar that if I take a negative charge and it's sitting here, it will polarize the medium around it. And it will attract the positive charges towards. See, this is a negative charge. It will attract the positive charges in the medium towards it. And a negative charge, it will repel. So if I bring a charge from outside and it is looking at this negative charge, it's actually going to see less of a negative charge. So it gets screened. Whereas in the case of the charge that a quark sees, the gluon charge, the situation for various reasons is exactly opposite. So the charge that a quark sees on another quark or the another gluon actually increases as, that's where the logarithm of R, it has a funny behavior. It doesn't decrease as you go to larger distances. It actually increases. So the larger distances are not allowed. So it comes back. So that's why the gluon cannot mediate something which is large distance. It has to mediate something only at short distances. And this is a very complicated theoretical problem called confinement. And As a matter of fact, there is a Clay Institute award for solving the confinement problem. So,
So whoever, this question was anonymous, but whoever wrote that, perhaps that is something you look into in your future career.
No, this is an important question, and I think this is the best I could do without going into any form.
I personally really like that rubber band analogy. I haven't used that myself, but I must admit I will be stealing it from now on. on a related question to that, there's another question. How can the exchange of bosons lead to both attractive but also repulsive forces?
That's again a very good question. I mean, I really thank my audience. I mean, these are very nice questions. Now, whether a boson will, or any exchange will give rise to an attractive force or a repulsive force, or what will be the position dependence of that force, what will be the dependence on the spins of the two objects, all this depends on the spin of the exchange object and on the two charges. See, some interactions, for example, like electromagnetic interactions, any force is finally proportional to the product of the charges. Now, if the product of the charges is positive, the force is repulsive. If the product of the charges is negative, the force is attractive, because negative potentials are attractive potentials and the positive potentials are repulsive potentials. So gravitation, for example, is always attractive, right? Because the product is positive.
Thank you. I think that was a very clear explanation. Okay, a couple more questions. I'm going to pair these two together because there's a couple that are asking about conservation and violation. So one question is, are spin and orbital angular momentum conserved separately? And is this not a violation of special relativity? And another question, assigning a value of spin and its direction, does this not violate the uncertainty principle? So I think these are kind of related, and again, they're along the same. So I wanted to pose them together.
Well, let me just get the questions right, because I think though you have put them together, I think let us take them separately.
Indeed, but they're related. Okay. But yeah,
they're related, but I think it's better to take them separately. Now, first thing is that the spin and the orbital angular momentum are not conserved separately. It is the total angular momentum that is conserved. So this is something we see in atomic spectroscopy all the time. Okay. So I think clearly these two are not separately conserved. So that's the first answer. It's the total angular momentum that is conserved. And you can see enough examples of that in nuclear transitions, in atomic transitions, and in many situations. Or when you determine the when you determine the energy levels of an electron in an atom, so on and so forth, this is always there, and it's the total angular momentum that gets conserved, because as you correctly said, it's the rotational invariance tells me that the total angular momentum is conserved. Now, I am not sure what the second question was, so I would let Melissa come online again and tell me the second question.
The second question is, I've just lost it. Okay. So assigning a value of spin and its direction, does that not violate the uncertainty principle?
I don't understand what you mean by this, because as we talk of quantum mechanically, we will only talk about average values. So it's not as though that while explaining things, one can always take a state of a definite spin and a definite spin projection and do mathematical manipulations with it. The next question is, can I create a particle state with a particular spin projection and with a particular value of the spin? And people try to do that. And indeed, there are issues with this, but the general statements that one is making in quantum mechanics are about averages. And creating states with exactly special spin and special things, they can be done, but that is actually complications and understanding. But otherwise, in general discussions here, I'm talking only of averages. And then there is no violation of any. Otherwise, I could not talk of position operator at all, or evolution of position operator even. So that's not the case. I hope this answer is acceptable.
That was my reading of it too, and I hope our audience member who posed that is happy with that. But I think that case of averages is exactly what we're talking about. So, well, there's one other question, a bit of a request. You might not have this, sir, but it has been asked. Do you have a nice visualization for the course of the force and the attraction between charged particles? And they say they can imagine a repulsion by the exchange of virtual photons between electrons.
I don't really have a visualization, but I think it is in the same level as I said, okay, that it depends on the sign of the charges. I mean, that's all I can say. But, it's the question is only of the direction, right? If you can visualize the existence of a force or a potential, then the question is only about the direction of the lines. If you like, in the language of field language, it's the question of whether your field lines are convex this way or convex this way. Let's put it that way. And that will depend really on the sign of the charge. So that's that would be one way of visualizing, but I'm giving it off the cuff right now. I will have to think. Fraser, it's a very nice question though. I see it's a question by Fraser. So I would like to appreciate your question, but right now I can only give this very small, simple answer.
Well, I'm afraid, Dr. Godbole, that we have once again gone over our time, and I this is my fault, not yours. I am the chair, but it's just so interesting.
I'm so sorry. So Nathaniel is not happy.
I mean, I'm just squeezing everything we can out of this, you know, because I really want to hear it myself. So apologies to the IOP and the IPA for taking a little bit more time than we should have here. But I hope that our audience, like our panel, have really enjoyed this. So all I have left to do now is to thank Professor Rohini Godbole, from the bottom of my heart. It's been an absolute pleasure chairing these last two sessions with you, and to make an announcement for our next session, which is coming up on the 18th of November at 4 p.m. And that is going to be on Professor Godbole's other key interest in women in science, and in particular women in science in India. And she actually has a textbook on the matter, which you can view through the webpage for this, the title of that. And it is a very, very fascinating read. And the title of this next talk is going to be Women in Science in India, Status and Prospects. So this is a very, very fascinating talk, I think, to all of us. It's not just relevant to women, it's relevant to all of us working in the field. Exactly. And something that is going to be very closely considered both now and in those coming years, so we can all be a part of this. And I think hearing the views of someone like yourself who's been working this area for some time will be a really, really fascinating talk. So please do come along. If you've enjoyed this one or the last one or both, do please come along to that on Wednesday the 18th at 4 p.m. So thank you again. Thank you to the IOP. Thank you to the IPA. Thank you in particular to Professor Rohini Godbole. And it has been my pleasure. I wish everyone a wonderful weekend.